In this video, we're going to take a look at converting a frequency table into a histogram. And this is the frequency table that we made in the last video. And here we had our class limits, class boundaries, midpoints, frequencies, and relative frequencies. One thing I also didn't mention in the last video, but that tends to be really handy, if you know how many pieces of data you were starting with, in this case, we were starting with 40 individual pieces of data, one of the things that you can do to double check to make sure you've counted everything properly and computed your relative frequencies properly is that all of your frequencies, when you total them, should add up to how many pieces of data there are. So when we add all of these up, in this case, they should total to 40. And when we add up all of our percentages, they should come out to 100%. And as long as those two things both add up to the total number of pieces of data and 100%, that's just a way to double check and make sure you didn't double count a piece of data or forget to count a piece of data every now and again. That will happen. So then once we have this frequency table, we want to convert it into a graphical display. This is a nice way to look at data. We can see, you know, what the relative percentages of data falling into any of these given classes is. So, you know, 7.5% of the data is values 1 through 3. 42.5% of the data, the most popular class, is data values 7 to 9. And that's useful information. But we might also, for some audiences, want to convert this into a graphical data display. That might be a handier way for people to look at things. And that's really what a histogram does. A histogram takes a frequency table and converts it into a graphical display. The way that we can do that, we can create two different kinds of histograms. We can create what's just a basic histogram, or we can create a relative frequency histogram. We'll talk about that in a minute. But basically, a histogram is simply a bar chart where the bars touch. The bars have to touch in a histogram. There cannot be space between the bars. That, believe it or not, is why we spent time in the last video forcing these class boundaries to meet rather than having a one-unit gap between the 3 and the 4. We had to force these two to meet so that the bars would touch when we make the histogram. That's why we have a need for both class limits and class boundaries. The other important thing to know about histograms is that they can only be used with quantitative data. They are not to be used with qualitative data. If we had qualitative data, we would use a bar chart instead, and it wouldn't be necessary for the bars to touch. But with a histogram, we're using that for quantitative data, the bars will touch. Okay. Now, this data happened to be quantitative. This was looking at length of time being put on hold. So these 40 pieces of data above was length of minutes, caller was put on hold. Okay. So we can see that length of minutes, that definitely qualifies as quantitative data. So we're going to create a histogram for that. And let's take a look at our histogram. In order to make a histogram, you need two axes. You're going to have a horizontal axis and a vertical axis. And of course, if you want this to look really, really nice, you would do this on graph paper with a straight edge and it would come out gorgeous. Or you could use a software package to design one for you so that you're not doing it by hand. And then your horizontal axis will be labeled with the name of your variable. And in this case, our variable was length of minutes on hold. Okay, so that's what the label for the x-axis will be. The y-axis will just be labeled frequency. Okay, so there's our labels, length of minutes on hold and the frequency. Then your x-axis will get little tick marks for its increments. So we need to figure out what increments we want to use along our x-axis. And basically what we would do is we would put our class boundaries on here. So our first class had a lower boundary of 0.5 and then went up to 3.5. Next class went from 3.5 to 6.5, then 6.5 to 9.5, 9.5 to 12.5, and 12.5 to 15.5. And these should all be the same width. That was the whole point. We were forcing a class width of 3 for this data set so that all these classes would be 3 units wide. So they should all be equally distant when we're putting them on the graph. Also, you'll notice that this increment here looks like more than a half a unit away from 0. So you'll want to put one of those break symbols in there to indicate that this part of the graph is not to scale. If our lowest class boundary happened to start at 0, then we wouldn't need that break symbol. But in this case, if we're altering the number of units in here or what that looks like, you need to put the break symbol in there. And then up the side, we're going to put the frequency. Our lowest class had a frequency of 1. Our highest class had a frequency of 17. So we need to be able to go all the way up to 17. You can do that in units of 1, 2, 5, 10, whatever increments make sense. Since we only need to go as high as 17, maybe I'll go up in units of 2. Okay, and again, those should be equidistant. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, and 18. And then basically the height of the bar in each class is going to represent the frequency of data values in that class. So this first class that had boundaries of 0.5 to 3.5 had a frequency of 3. So that should be 3 units tall. Then from 3.5 to 6.5 was 15, so that should be 15 units tall. The next one, 6.5 to 9.5, that was the 17, so that should go all the way up to 17. Then the next one, 9.5 to 12.5, had a frequency of 4. And then the very last one had a frequency of 1. And so this would be our histogram. And it's a really nice graphical way to see how your data are distributed. We can see, for example, that these are the most popular classes here between 3.5 and 9.5, and that there's actually very little data on either side of that. If we wanted to make a relative frequency histogram instead of a regular histogram, the heights of the bars would be percents. And they would come from the final column over here, the relative frequency column. These percentages would form the height of each of the bars. And I'll leave it to you to do as an exercise, but you'll find if you do that, if you make a relative frequency histogram, while the scale here will change, the relative spacing of the bars will be the same. You'll get essentially the exact same picture of how the data are distributed in the relative frequency histogram that you do in a regular histogram, which should happen because it's only one set of data and they are only distributed in one particular way. So we shouldn't get a completely different picture just because we choose a different unit system for that y-axis column, or for the y-axis there. So that's how you make a histogram, or if you wanted to, you could do a relative frequency histogram with the percentages up here. Last thing that I want to mention in this video is ways to look at these histograms. There are a few common shapes that histograms come in, and they can each tell you something really interesting about your set of data. And so when we're describing a histogram, there are a few different common shapes, and we might use descriptions of those shapes to talk about this histogram here. The first one is mound-shaped and symmetric. And that would be a histogram if it were perfectly symmetric. You know, it would look something like this. This would be a mound-shaped and symmetric distribution, but it doesn't have to be identical on both sides to qualify as symmetric for statistical purposes. It could just be roughly symmetric. So if it's got kind of this hump in the middle and then it's relatively symmetric on either side, that's a mound-shaped or symmetric distribution. And this hump part, the highest part of the distribution, that's referred to as the mode. So this particular data distribution is also said to be unimodal because it has only one single high point, one single hump there. Okay, so that's a unimodal distribution, unimodal and symmetric, or mound-shaped and symmetric. You'll notice that our data up here, same actual kind of thing. If you imagine superimposing a curve kind of on top of here, we can see it is roughly unimodal. Well, actually, it is unimodal. It's got only one main hump of data right there, and it's roughly symmetric on both sides. So that would be a mound-shaped and symmetric distribution. Other interesting types of distribution shapes. There is the uniform distribution. Now, the way that your book draws this picture, it's completely flat across the top. Doesn't have to be completely flat. There can be a little bit of wiggling up and down. But the bars should be roughly all the same height across the top. And that's called a uniform distribution. It is also, by definition, symmetric. Since if you cut it in half down the middle, both sides essentially match up. Okay, so it's uniform and symmetric. Other interesting distribution shapes are the skewed distributions. Skewed is when your data are distributed in a non-symmetric fashion. So you can have a set of data that looks maybe, for example, like this. This would be unimodal, again, because it's got this one main hump right here. And then you see how it's got kind of this tail that trails off to the right-hand side? So that would be unimodal and skewed right. The skew in the distribution always goes in the direction of the tail. So if the tail of the data is longer on the right than it is on the left, that's a skewed right distribution. Similarly, we could have some data where something like this, again, unimodal, because there's one main hump of data. And this would be skewed left, because we've got this tail trailing off on the left-hand side. And then, excuse me, the last type of distribution shape that you might run into is a bimodal distribution. Or you can have trimodal, multimodal. But basically, a bimodal means that there's two modes. So if we had a distribution that looked, say, something like this, here, there's not just one main hump of data. There's kind of a main hump over here, and there's another main hump over here. And the key is that those main humps, the tallest bars, are roughly equivalent to one another. They don't have to be at exactly the same height, but if this one were, say, way down here, if all the rest of this data were down here, that would not count as bimodal. They have to be roughly the same height, and they have to be separated by some distance. And that's what qualifies that to be a bimodal distribution. There are two main humps of the data. This type of distribution is really important to look at because it sometimes arises when you have inadvertently grouped two separate groups of data together in the same data display. So as an example, let's say we were looking at shoe size, and let's say I'd collected a bunch of shoe size information, and I put it on this graph, but I neglected to separate out by gender. I just had a bunch of sizes. Well, here's going to be all the women down here. This would be, say, the average size of a woman's shoe. There's going to be some women with smaller than average feet and some with higher than average feet, but most will be average. And then over here, let's say this was the men and this was average size for men. Well, there's going to be some men with smaller feet than average, some men with larger feet than average, but most will be around average. And here I've created a bimodal distribution. I essentially have two separate groups that just got inadvertently put together in the same graph. So if you see a bimodal distribution when you graph it, one thing that can be telling you is, have we inadvertently grouped two different groups together? Two different groups together when we put the data in the graph? And if that's something you didn't know ahead of time, sometimes you can find that out when you create the graph. And then that's really it for making the histograms by hand. There is another video that will show you how to make the histograms using your calculator.